Hey everybody, this is Sheets along with Bobby Fye and also SP. So as I mentioned to you guys a couple of weeks ago, there's a site called Sports, Sports Projection, Sports-Projection, which does some interesting stuff as far as analyzing contests. And as you guys know, I'm always on the hunt for kind of new tools and anything that can help everybody get better. And, you know, I have my own kind of dream stuff that I wish existed. And I wish that, you know, I had the programming knowledge to make work. And this isn't exactly it, but I always, when I hear of things like this, I kind of want to, have the person on that created it to kind of show us how to walk through it. And so what we're going to do is I'm going to share my screen. I could have had him share his screen, but I always feel it's better for me to do it this way. Obviously, the person who runs the site is going to be really easy at that, well, weaving in and out of it or whatever it is. But just to, it's kind of interesting to watch like a normal person kind of struggle, you know. So maybe SP can kind of walk me through this and just basically how to make good use of this. Now, the good thing is, SP, is that we picked a good day to do this because we're firing up the LEC slate, and I actually think that I'm in first with a single and. Or close with a single with a unique lineup right off the bat. Well, so anyway, we'll talk about that. So tell me, I don't need to go into all your history or something, but tell me what this is, why you created it, and what you think some good uses are for it.
Yeah. Well, first off, thanks for having me on. So a little bit of background on this is effectively I'm a DFS player. I was playing DFS, and you know, as the rise of some of the sports, particularly where you know, ownership is important in all DFS sports, but particularly where uniqueness, I would say, has an increased importance. So some of those sports include like NFL Showdown, MMA, League of Legends, as you were just talking about, where uniqueness is particularly of a concern. You know, one of the things that I wanted to look at for myself was what do my lineups look like compared to the rest of the field? How duplicated are they? How much total salary is everybody using? Are they stacking different positions or just, you know, NFL Showdown captain together? So basically I had built, you know, on my sort of backend processes, these things look at slates after the fact. And eventually I thought it got to a point where I thought I could put this all together in a tool, and it'd be useful for other people as well. Because none of the information here is that summarized or what's done in this tool. Everything can be done via the contest CSV for the most part. But I know a lot of people don't have necessarily the Excel skills or technical skills to do that. So really the idea of this is really to just have a tool that helps people summarize their contests and see how their lineups are and investigate top players or whatever in an efficient, streamlined way.
So let's get right into it. So first of all, all these sports here are the ones that you, I don't want to say cover in the wrong way, but these are your site handles all these sports that I'm showing here.
Yeah, that's the idea.
Okay. So what I did was that.
So go ahead.
No, what I was going to say, so I actually created my most recent CSV files for both LOL and tennis and golf and MMA so that we could kind of show how this works, like how we can navigate through this and how we can kind of learn from it. So I guess we would start by, so I guess you have to start with the CSV file first, right? So what I'm going to do, and if I'm doing this wrong, you let me know. I think I have this down. So the first thing you do is you get the file. So we go to browse, and I already know where I saved it. So that's, but usually you would just download it from the contest lobby, and wherever you save it, you just kind of save it. And so this is the LEC file from today. And then I guess what you have to do is pick what contest you're doing. So this is, now does it automatically pick it for you based on what I've uploaded, or I have to actually select from the dropdown?
Yeah, you actually have to select the dropdown. It's not currently smart enough to go in there and look at you know, results or okay. what contests you see CSV. And the whole purpose of that sort of third input about why you put the date and then have to select the contest is on the back end, you know, in the contest CSV, there's no information related to what team each player is on and their salary and whatnot. So that piece is how the lookup for the salary information and some of like the input files before the slate are pulled in.
So this is my LS. Now, where would you start here? Now that this is uploaded, so I have all these different choices of what I could do. Like, where would you start with user exposures, user entry investigation? Like, give me a little tour. Well, how would you use this?
Yeah. So for me, usually the first tab I go to is user exposures. User unique percentage.
Oh wow. Okay.
And then what I look, you know, first and foremost for me usually is I'll look at how, like, you know, my entries, how unique they are, just at a glance, like how my entries are shaking out. I'll also look at, you know, if I'm studying other players or trying to figure out what some of the top players are doing, I'll also look at that. But this gives you a quick idea on sort of the summary of how you're submitting.
So this dude at the top, he's in my Discord all the time, the Emblem Man. And he seems to always have like these, I don't want to say crazy lineups, right? Because there's always, especially in these types of sports, there's always kind of like that fine line you have to draw between, you know, in all DFS sports, right? Between getting unique and having, and also having a chance to win, right? And I can come up with unique lineups in football if I pick all guys that aren't playing, right? So it's not just being unique, but it's walking that, you know, it's striking that balance between being unique and, you know, and also having hope, you know, and having a shot. But this dude is always here. Now, again, I don't want to jump ahead, but you ever consider, I mean, I presume that you can do this, but you ever think about kind of combining the two, like analyzing users, not just by uniqueness, based on, you know, some sort of projection or some sort of simulation, how much chance they really have of any of these unique entries hitting, or is this just, or that's kind of like beyond your skill set, or is it something that it's not even worth talking about?
No, I think, yeah, you bring up a really good point, and it's certainly worth talking about. So yeah, in of itself, uniques, it's not like you can just submit unique lineups in any sport, and that's like the key to success, right? So for me, the sports I play, you know, like I have my own projections or simulations or whatnot. And you're exactly right. You want to balance like what percent of the time these lineups actually do well or win versus what the payoff is for them. You know, in terms of incorporating something like that into a tool like this, the challenge with that becomes, one, I would need sort of like a simulation source for any sport I'm covering. And two, even if sort of I allowed users to input projections, their own projections, it still becomes a challenge simulating what those look like the distribution or the range of outcomes. So, you know, this I think, again, is not the end all be all. It's not like, again, the best lineups are submitted by the person who submits the most uniques. I find in the sports I play at least, and have looked at in the past, generally it's a balance of, you want to submit as many, you know, uniques as you can, but if you're submitting all uniques, generally you're probably submitting lineups that have too low of a probability of hitting.
Do you play League of Legends?
I do, yes.
Okay. Because, you know, people in our Discords are, you know, we don't have the biggest Discord in the world, but the people that are in there are usually pretty sharp, and they have some really, really interesting questions. And one of the sharper guys, you know, asked me when within the last, you know, couple of months, they've just basically upped everything as far as League of Legends stuff. Like, they've made the first prize a little bit bigger, and more to the point, they've extended the amount of lineups that people can play. And he suggested the idea that, well, you know, when you give people the opportunity to make, like, you know, 117 lineups or whatever the max is for a particular contest, it provides, one thing it does is it certainly provides like more like negative EV lineups for people to play, right, for openers. But also it makes it kind of harder to hit, you know, to hit it on your own with a lineup that has a chance, because there's just that many more combinations kind of being played, you know. So we kept on, I would say, arguing, talking back and forth between, is the ability to enter like 117 lineups good for the people that only enter 20 or 30, right? Or is it worse? You know, I would argue, you know, I want to get your opinion, but like on both, like it helps both ways. Like a person's going to enter 117 lineups in a 2-game slate, you'd have to think that a whole bunch of them, I don't say a whole bunch, right? Because that's not pretty analytical, but a lot of them don't have much of a shot. But then again, like all those kind of like one-off lineups that you really couldn't get to when you can only play like 37 or something like that, all of a sudden become in play when now you can play 117. And you see like Embleman, I mean, he's got everything when he's in, you know what I mean? Like you look at this particular slate, he's got like 43.2 like average salary, like for example. So like you said, it is an interesting thing to talk about balance about that. Do you have any opinion on that? What I just said about since you play League of Legends?
Yeah. I mean, in general, the way I think about, you know, contest size and max entries and whatnot is, really, I think in general, as a guiding principle, you want the contest to be as big as possible. And even if you're not submitting as like, even if you're not max entering, you're submitting one lineup or 20 or whatever, or max entering, you really want the contest to be as big as possible, because the smaller the contest, usually the higher proportion of professionals or people taking this semi-seriously make up the total pool. Because to me, that's really the important thing in any contest or sport is understanding like what percent of the, a lot of times you can look at it easily, and you can do that through the tool here, what percent of the total entries are submitted by max enterers. And that's honestly, I think a better gauge of the difficulty of a contest than probably anything else. In general, is that the contest just gets bigger, you know, rationally the number of the percent that the max enterers make up goes down.
So I know the answer to the question, as most things with DFS, is, well, it's slate dependent, but what's like a good, you know, based on your analysis, a good unique percentage to be looking for, you know, like this is, we're rating, how are we ranking these guys actually? We're ranking them by how are we ranking?
Just number of uniques, like net total uniques.
Oh, the total uniques.
Yeah, right.
Okay. So if we rated them, say, by, we could do this, right? By unique percentage. It was like really funny. This is the guy in my Discord, actually. This is Adam Perry, by the way, Bobby. He only plays at 10 or 20, and he has basically all of them unique, you know, whatever. Like what for like someone who's playing like 20, 30 lineups is, I don't want to say good, because I guess the answer is always, it depends on the slate, right? But
Yeah. I mean, especially with something like League of Legends, it's really slate dependent, because you know, the slate you're looking at is, I believe, a 5-game slate. And so there's going to be a lot more combinations. And so there, I would say your unique percentage, you should want to be substantially higher than if you were playing, say, a 2-game slate, just because there's fewer combinations. And it's very different between sports as well. Like MMA would be quite different than NFL Showdown, would probably be different from League. Basically the way I think about it is, again, without actually simulating, it's hard to answer that question. But what I would, like a guiding principle, I would say for most people is in the big sports like NFL Showdown, MMA, ones with like tons and tons of entries, I would generally try and avoid anything that has over 5 to 7 duplicates is generally what I would tell if I was just telling someone to strive for. I would generally tell them, once you get over that, it becomes, it's not impossible, certainly, but it becomes harder and harder for that to be a good lineup. For something like League of Legends, where the slate sizes are much smaller, you know, I personally would probably be, especially on when there's, you know, 4 or 5 game slates, maybe even bigger, I would be trying to submit, you know, 75% plus of But then you know, you're also like, you can do that if you use every different team or whatever negatively correlate or something. So you don't want to do that. But you can aim much higher when
that's an interesting point. And you know, Bobby and I, we talk about this when we play NFL Showdown a lot. Is you know, obviously you want to be unique, and the question is to what extent do you want to force uniqueness? In other words, like what steps, you obviously don't know whether you're going to be unique necessarily, you know, when you put the lineup in, right? But we talk about like different things you can do, like, you know, the obvious thing is to max your salary, right? In a certain way. And it's always, again, you struggle with this, like when you do stuff like that, how much projection integrity, I like to say, are you willing to give up, you know, to force yourself to be somewhat unique, you know, and then I guess you're talking about what type of contest it is, right? So if NFL Showdown, like anything can freaking happen, it seems, you know. So that's one thing. So I don't know, with League of Legends, like you said, there's very few ways to kind of force uniqueness, I guess. I guess this is the way I like to play is this, when I want to use your tools, is if I play like normal, if I run Saber Sim, I run my projections and I run my optimals or whatever it is. And when I, not even my optimals, when I run my lineups and I see before I enter them that a whole bunch of them are less than, you know, are leaving like 3,000-4,000 on the table without me forcing it that way, I'm kind of happy about that, you know, because then I'm probably, I guess, going to get unique. Now, again, if you learn any correlation between this, like average salary, unique percentage, you'd have to think that is something, one has something to do with the other, right?
Absolutely. If you go to the salary investigation tab, I think that parlays exactly to your line of questioning, is exactly why I built this tab. So what this shows is how much total salary each lineup uses. It sort of like sums it up at the total salary level. So for example, a little small on my screen, but it looks like 196 of the entrants used the full salary here. And what you're going to see in like every contest, it's a little, so league, it's a little bit harder to see because again, size and just the way salaries are not continuous necessarily in the same way. But what you're always going to see is the unique percentage is going to be generally lowest at the highest salaries. Again, league, small slate potentially, it's not as many entries. But if you were to do something like this in MMA, I haven't looked in a little bit, but I believe generally over like 50% of the lineups use, you know, within a couple hundred of 50,000. And so, yeah, you can use this to sort of say, all right, what are the cutoff points of what most people are building, or like what salary constraints, and you know, can use that to your advantage. Again, maybe not the cleanest on a league slate, but that's the idea of that tab.
Now, this is, I kind of struggle when I go through this sometimes. So this is the user entry investigation. So this is when you want to find out, I guess, like what, you know, which of your lineups are unique, right?
Correct. So what I would generally do is, after looking at that user unique percentage, what I'm going to do is then I'm going to say maybe 70% of my lineups are under five, and there's a handful of lineups that are over 20 duplicated. I want to go look at those because I want to try and fix whatever problem in my process is leading me to that. I want to try and resolve that. So I want to look at which lineups were duped more than I would want. So, you know, here, again, it's hard to say without simulating, but like me personally, I probably wouldn't want to submit a lineup that was duplicated 18 times. So yeah. I would sort of go back, look at that and think like, what led me to this? How can I avoid these? What lineups were, and then you could do it the reverse, which lineups were low owned, you know, that I think are good and reasonable lineups, and how can I submit more of those going forward?
And so these are the, and these are the, when I reverse sort by frequency, these are the ones that are going to be, these are going to be the unique ones.
Right. If the frequency is one, that means it was, yeah, submitted one time. So I think in league, honestly, anytime you could submit a lineup that, you know, only uses two teams, maybe sometimes uses three, and is unique, is generally probably an okay lineup, if not a good one.
And again, for I guess for sweating purposes also, I mean, you could see like everybody, like you said, that used a certain guy in the captain and stuff like that, right?
Yeah. So the part that I was really excited to add is those filtered, the two boxes at the top. Because I guess in league, it's a little bit easier because like there are positions and whatnot, but this is how I, you know, when I do watch MMA or NFL Showdown or whatever, this is how I will sweat the game is basically if first fight goes off and fighter one wins and fighter two loses, you can immediately filter every lineup to that, to get out rid of all the losing fighters, get rid of all the lineups keep if the winning fighter has a really high score, filter to that. And you could see like which of your lineups are still live.
Right.
And like which ones are dead. And so it's like, especially if you get down to the end, you know, the whole night is sort of a process of whittling out lineups and whatnot.
Yeah.
And so you get to a point where maybe there's like 100 lineups and you're one of the 100 and you know exactly what you're sweating for. Cause sometimes it becomes challenging to know what you want, but you can sort of see that with that feature. So yeah, I mean, this is like how I sweat.
Before I go to the other sport, is there anything I'm missing as far as like what I should be using here or?
If you go to the user exposures tab, I think that could potentially be interesting. It's a little cluttered with so many players in league, but this basically compares, this has the ability to compare your exposures or anybody's exposures versus the field. The default is set to compare the max enters versus the field. And so to me, this is a good snapshot in a lot of sports of like, where are the max enters overweight? Not that the max enters are like the end all be all of what you should be doing, but it can be somewhat informative. And so then you could also like, if you go to the filter where max enters are and type in your name, you can, this is also like one of the first things I look at.
Wait, so I'm looking, so where do I type in?
I think you can just like backspace and type.
Okay.
And type in, and it should like auto fill. Yeah, there you go. And so then you can see like, this is also what I use at the beginning, like of the MMA slate or League of Legends slate, because you can see who am I like overweight relative to the field on. And again, you sort of like know exactly what you're rooting for right off the bat. So this is also helpful that regard.
So let's do tennis. How about that? Because we're in tennis today, and then we'll do MMA. Because MMA the analytical term was a shit show this past week, because there was a fight canceled in the middle, and it was only 11 fights, so it became a battle of who wants to leave 1,000 on the table or more. But hold on, let me. So let's do. Again, let's go back to the beginning. So let's browse. We're going to find the tennis one that I saved because we're live in that right now. And so it's here. So now I got to go and I got to find tennis here, right? Mm-hmm. And then the only one it shows is late.
Okay. So like I mentioned, the process is to scrape directly from DraftKings. I know you and I had some separate conversation. That may not be pooling. And so I always advise people, let me know. The tool will still work in everything, except you won't have salary information. You can still look at the number of uniques and whatnot, but the salary information, if your slate isn't there, won't come through. And I can look to see, sometimes back-end processes just.
So let's do this again. So let's go from here. So we'll go to user. No, not user entry, user exposures again, right? No, we want to start with
user unique percentage. Yeah.
Okay. So this is so this guy only had, this guy's always usually good, Jesus runner. But this is, I don't know what slate this is though, because this can't be the slate that I uploaded, because this is the late slate that it's dragging actually.
The contest CSV is for the late slate or no?
No, the contest CSV is the main slate, but because this is defaulting to late, it's giving me the information on the late slate, I think.
I would have to look at the CSV you uploaded.
Okay. Well, here, we can do it again. So this is... there she is. Oh, look at this. We're rich. Just everybody has to... Everybody has to just not play the rest of the day. All right, so let's... That's pretty cool. So let's do... the line painter, because the line painter has more, maybe this is the one, because let's just see, which one do you want to do? Let's do this one, because there's more entries.
Yeah, it looks like maybe which one you pulled was that one with fewer entries, where it was a 7-entry max.
Okay.
So, I think maybe this was one maybe you had intended to pull.
Yeah, so let's... I want to save this somewhere. So let's go back. I will browse and then go back to here. Okay, let's see. Yeah, it's still for some reason.
Yeah, that won't populate because whatever.
Oh, okay.
If I can't grab it, and I have to grab it before.
There it is. Like, you got it. It's all good. It's all right here.
Right. Yeah. But you see, like, the salary information isn't populated. That's what's not going to come through if you can't select the right slate. But again, most of the functionality is there, and I'll look to see why that didn't grab.
So 21 unique. So let's have some fun. So I'm going to go into the. Into and see who's doing well and who's doing poorly, and then, like you said, we'll X out guys that are
absolutely.
We'll X out guys that are dead. Okay, so all right, so Ostapenko is dead, and we'll start with that one. And Lacheka is dead. So let's go back into what's a user entry investigation, or I forget.
Yep.
Okay, so we do not want Ostapenko. So she's, so just like that?
Is the name should come up. Did it not?
It did.
Is that how you spell the name?
That's I don't know question. Tennis. Let's see. Asta, O-S-T-A. Oh, there it is. Oh, sorry. So O-S-T-A.
Why doesn't she show up? Is she not in this list?
It's just maybe I upload the wrong slate or something. I'm not sure.
I don't have many tennis users that I know of, so this is good. Where I apologize that this is happening on
no, screen, no. Listen, this is why we're doing this. I could care less. But that's what we would do here. So let's then go. Now, is it useful to do it with MMA that happened already?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, so let's do that. Let's go back and we'll go to the MMA, which for me was a complete disaster. So we can certainly embrace that. So you talk about forcing yourself to be unique. This was a perfect example of it. All right, so here's the MMA slate from this past Saturday. So
So I think you got to set that to Saturday then, date of the actual contest.
Okay. Oh, very good.
And then you probably want the main slate. Yeah.
Right. So just to give you guys a little bit of summary. So I was in Florida over the weekend and I put some lineups in, and then what happened was one fight was ruled out. That was the Vidal fight. That was Cowan. And then I think there was another one that was ruled out. So what I did was I went and I said, you know what? Forget this. For 11 fights, I'm going to just leave 1,000 on the table in like all my lineups, right? But I forgot what that would end up doing. Okay, so what I ended up doing was, well, you'll see what I did. Let's just pull it up. So we're going to user entry investigation or user exposures. I keep forgetting this one. All right. Yep. So here we go. So lineups containing these players. So let's, the first fight of the night was, it was Altamirano versus Salvador. So what we probably do is we don't know if Altamirano is going to be optimal yet, but we knew that Salvador was not. Right.
Right. Yeah. So that's generally, so, you know, it, when a fight happens, if you basically always want to filter out the loser, but you only I only filter in sort of the winner if it's a very, very high score.
If you're sure. Really, right. 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 Yeah. Right. And then can you put one next to the other here? Once you have this?
Yeah. You can put as many as you want in there in both boxes. So they sort of, both boxes sort of just get more and more populated as the night goes on.
Right. Okay. But so that's, I try to block this whole thing out of my system. What was the next fight? It was the silver in the next one. So this one's actually kind of interesting because Vergara, this is one I ended up with zero of, because I really wanted a lot of exposure to the Silva. And then I decided that I was going to leave 1,000 on the table. And when you always leave 1,000 on the table, the $9,300 fighter doesn't usually show up. So I ended up with zero Vergara. So this was a weird fight because Vergara smashed, but it was a weird thing that De Silva actually had two knockdowns, like in a loss. So while it's not, it's not guaranteed. I mean, he at 6,800 had 44 points, and I've seen that kind of win. So I wouldn't necessarily X him out yet. So
yeah, especially on what ended up being a 10 fight card, 11,
something like that. Okay,
exactly where it landed.
So then it went to Giles. I think Giles and what's his name was next. Giles and Parsons, and Parsons lost, so he would be out. And Giles, he didn't smash, so that was nothing. So now we have the big one. So this was Pineda, was an underdog against I blocked it all on my system. Pineda was an underdog to Tucker Lutz. Tucker Lutz was 9,200 and got subbed in the second round. So Lutz would be out. So we would do this. And I guess like slowly but surely, you'd want to put, should I put my username here as well? Or
yep, that's usually what I do. So you could see how many lineups you have live, and then so you could sort of scroll down and see how many you have live.
Look what I did. Oh, okay.
Yeah, so you see you have maybe like 60 still live.
I still have a bunch.
Okay. Right. As you go, this gets shorter, but also.
And also what you could do is see, so I will look at this, I have a whole bunch of unique still alive as well.
Right, exactly.
Which is great news. However, the problem was that in that fight, Pineda got a second round KO as a decent underdog. So you probably want to put him in. Would you do that, you think, at that point? Maybe not.
I didn't follow the slate. How many points did he score?
Yeah, he scored I think he scored like 100 at like 7K flat.
I would generally put him in, and you can always take him out, but at something like that,
we can't put him in because I think I had zero of him, because so it would give me zero. We don't want to have that. We don't have no fun.
Okay, right.
So then we had Duraev against he was the, not against Cop. Cop got whatever. Oh, so you had Peterson as the favorite. He lost. So now we're down to, we got to keep putting mine in. So we still are doing well, because I don't think I had any of him. Whoever it was that Daraya beat. Njokwani lost. So he's out. And this, so you just keep doing this along the way. Okay.
Right, as each fight goes. And so now you see you're down to roughly 252 times 10. So like 2,500 lineups that you think are still live. And then you could filter to your name to say, of those 2,500, how many do I have? And ideally that percentage goes up throughout the night. So
So I, so like, there were chances, but the thing is that I kept the Silva in, right? And at this point, now that I have two underdogs that smashed. Yeah. Oh, so I know who you have to rule out. Here's the problem. Perez was scratched mid card. Mm-hmm. So he's out. And now we have a big problem because I think I have 80% of him. So let's see if I have anybody left. This is when you know you can turn the card off. Uh-oh, look at this. We're running out here. And unfortunately, right. Whoever Perez fought was out too. And that was... Is it Landwehr? No, it was... I forgot who Dariah fought, but whoever that was lost. Anyway, again, I'm not particularly adept at this, but that's what you do, and that's kind of a good way to sweat. Let's do one more. Let's do golf from this past weekend. Now, let's hope this one works because this was from. There were two slates. There was a match play slate and a regular one.
Does the match play? I don't personally play golf. Does the match play follow like the same format as normal golf? DFS, I mean.
It does.
Okay.
But I like, you know what I want to do? I'd like to go back to the League of Legends slate for a second. Let's just do this. Let's do the golf. Hold this up. This was from, and the date would be the 23rd, right?
Because that was right. Thursday. It started on
and
Thursday.
It would
yeah.
be this one, I think.
Yeah. Let's see. Probably that looks like.
Think, the yeah, one. Because the other one started Wednesday, right? Okay. So let's do the same thing. So user exposures or user unique percentage. I mean, it's not too difficult to get.
Right. All the salary information is in there. So it pooled right.
So I played 50 and 45 of them were unique. That's not a, so it's not, I don't want to say not as useful for golf, but it, because it's golf, you get unique pretty easily in golf.
Right. For golf, the tab that, and again, this could be clustered depending on how many golfers there are, but you could look at that user exposures tab. Because what this will show you, and again, there's a lot of golfers, but you could see like who you're overweight on relative to the field. I mean, a lot of this you would know, but you could see it's you're exactly right. It's less of a sport where uniques matter, depending on the field size and whatnot, and more of like exposures, I would say, and who you're overweight on relative. But you could sweat the same way. Like as your guys get cut, you can go to that tab and sort of filter those lineups out or whatever. So you could see your lineups that maybe still have six of six or whatever.
All right. So how would you, I guess this is kind of a weird way to ask, but like, so you charge for this now. What am I paying? Like eight, just so you know, everybody, full disclosure. I mean, I reached out to him because I am a user of the product. I mean, I'm not getting anything from this. I don't, you know, whatever it is. It's like $7 a month or something like that. Honestly, if it was just even sweat, I'd probably pay it. Honestly, because I like enjoy that. But and I could certainly analyze, you know, number of uniques and things like that. But you mentioned something that maybe you could go into a little more when you said, okay, so I would look at my lineups and I would try to think of how could I do better? I mean, how can you do better? You know what I mean? Like, and this is the thing I kind of struggle with, like Showdown and all these different, you know, unique type sports. Like how do you, because you don't know going in, right, whether you're going to be unique. You could do things to force it, right? You could reduce ownership, I suppose, limitations if you have good ownership projections. But how would you use the information to kind of get better, I guess?
Yeah, so I think of it in a couple different ways. Again, one, I look at for each sport where uniques matter, I definitely pay attention to that salary investigation tab. Because I if you go to that for golf, say on for here, if you click on that tab, not that
which one
unique, so, yeah, the salary investigation here, you'll see like it's really challenging to make unique lineups, it's a little bit more challenging to make with golf, because again, it's pretty spread out. It's a little bit more challenging to make unique lineups using the full 50K. If we were to look at this tab for the MMA again, which you'll see is like tons of people use the full salary or very close to it. So that's one aspect, is you sort of want to know the break points, I think, for every sport. If there's like, because again, you don't want to be leaving too much projection on the table. But you also, why don't we just open MMA? Because I think that'll illustrate the point better. I think you got to go back to Saturday. Sorry.
I apologize for being so quiet on this call. They're working on the house and it's an incredibly loud noise. So I'm just keeping myself muted, but I'm appreciating the information.
No, all good. All right, here's MMA.
Right. So this really illustrates the point. So basically, if you use the full 50,000, you only had only 4% of those lineups were unique. And so you are really trying to thread a small needle by using the full salary. Even using 49.8 plus, you only have, it looks like a 6 to me on my screen, percent of being unique. But as you get lower and lower salary, you see the likelihood of being unique or under 5 like dramatically go up. And so these are the break points I think you want to, and each slate's going to be a little bit different and each sport's a little bit different. So like for me, unless you have a very sophisticated process to like simulate and whatnot, my advice to most people would just don't submit a lineup that's 49.8 or more based on this, because you're just very likely to be duplicated a lot of times. And so that's one component. So you can look at each slate and see how sports change. I think the other thing that I do that is useful is if you were to go to the user exposures tab now, I don't know someone who you think is a very strong player, but you could go to Roto Grinders top whatever or whoever you think is a top player and look at their exposures and or look at several of them and understand who are they overweight on, who are they underweight on. Again, you could just like backspace and type in whoever you want.
So we'll pull up Will here, see how he goes.
Yeah, so like you can see what, if you believe his process is strong, then you could see where he's coming up and who he's overweight and or underweight on. Again, it's sort of a risky game because you're trying to sort of back engineer something, but it can at least let you know if you're potentially on the right track. So I've used this before in trying to understand like why are some players so heavy on things? What am I missing in my process from that's not getting me to that? So that's certainly a couple things I looked at. I guess the last thing that I think I briefly mentioned is on the user entry investigation tab. Every time I'll look at the lineups I submit, and if there are any that are way more duplicated than I thought they would be, based on my process, those are the ones that I want to figure out why my process is giving me those and potentially cut them out. Was my ownership projection wrong? Something else causing the issue, like correlation between fighters making your some product or whatever not as accurate as it could be. So it's generally, those are, I think, the three easiest ways and what I do to hopefully improve.
Well, you know, NFL Showdown, again, we're not going to be doing NFL Showdown for like another 8 months or whatever, but the NFL Showdown is this sport where I mess around with the salary and I kind of have these ideas that that there are sort of breakpoints that you want to do to kind of get unique over the people that are trying to get unique, sort of, you know, because listen, to leave salary on the table is certainly nothing new. And nonetheless, I mean, some people still max out 50K somehow. But what I always thought about is, okay, I know that people would leave, you know, 1,000 on the table, but maybe it's just less likely that they'll leave 1,100 or something like that, you know, or maybe if someone would leave 500 on the table, maybe that extra 100 makes a difference. Obviously, it's all slate dependent, and what one guy's salary is, you might get a projected guy that projects well that just is going to just lead you to lineups that are exactly 49.1, you know, or exactly 48.9 or something like that. But I think examining the breakpoints, like you mentioned, even though it probably does, you know, go slate to slate, I guess that could be somewhat useful also.
Right. I think it's pretty steady within sports. So, I mean, you'll see trends and changes if some people are specifically like underpriced on a slate, you know, then the average salary is going to be lower. But at least for MMA and some of the other sports I play, it's pretty constant what people do.
I want to go back to, and then I want to ask you something offline. I want to go back to League of Legends for a second, because here was a question that I had. Let me re-upload that LOL slate. So can you, when you're trying to sweat or whatever, can you, I guess you can only sort by team, by player, right? You can't like X a whole team out, right?
Yeah, that's, you know, in baseball, I know that hasn't really started yet, but baseball, because of the number of players and whatnot, it's done at team level. But league currently, yeah, it's at sort of like a player level. So you could filter out, you just have to type out all five names, I guess, or whatever, the lineups not containing these players.
Okay, let's do a real world thing. Let's take a look at this tennis thing for a second. Okay, so I'm 3-for-3, and so far it's in first place, whatever that means, right? Now I have a feeling it's not so great because this guy is really, really well salaried. But I want to see who I'm up against, right? I want to see who else has these three guys. So let's go back into tennis. Where was it? Oh, let's go. We got to go back to that file. Browse, right? Back into tennis. And this was the one we wanted. Okay. Wait, so this one's Miami. I think this is the one.
I think your date is set to Saturday. I think today.
Yeah.
And we didn't have the
salaries. Right. Okay, so let's go and we'll go user entries. All right, so let's only look at the guys that had
this was the same issue we were running into.
Oh no, it's there. Oh right, okay.
Like is I saw Tsitsipas was in it. He's not.
Yeah, it's pulling from a different. Yeah, okay, fair enough. Okay. So you could we'll use that as something for you to do in the off time.
Yes,
just to work on that. Okay. But ostensibly we could do that, right? Like if we would just put in these three guys.
The MMA exercise. Right.
Perfect. Okay, so you are you looking to develop your site? Are you looking, I mean, this is like kind of like you were doing it for yourself and you say like how many people can I get to pay bucks for it? Are you looking to develop it more? I mean, what are you looking to do with this?
Yeah, I'm open to, like I said, I appreciate you having me on and bringing some light to this. I'm very open to building different features or things people think are helpful. Like you mentioned, I think it's $8 a month. So this is not by any means like my full-time job. It's sort of just a passion project for me. And I enjoy building it and talking with people about it and DFS and whatnot. So if there are any ever suggestions from you all or anybody watching, I'm definitely open to it.
I definitely want to talk about that. I told Bobby, the one reason why I have you on here and I have these ideas for tools and these ideas for like even something so stupid as, you know, you watch MMA. I kind of want to know what my score is before they DraftKings makes it official. You know, it's like it's after a guy knocks a dude out, it takes like sometimes 10 minutes for them to put it up there. And I was looking into getting an API call from freaking ESPN so I could upload all the data before they come up with it. And League of Legends, you know how that goes, right? Sometimes it takes an hour and a half before they update like the League of Legends site. That's kind of, it's one thing to, I like to do two things. I like to create tools to analyze. I love to think of ways to sweat and like have fun, you know? So I just don't have, and Bobby either, between the two of us, we have literally zero programming skill set. And as far as Excel goes, I know literally just enough to cause a lot of pain, You know what I mean? Like I created an Excel spreadsheet and an Excel kind of thing where I aggregate projections from all over the industry and I weight them based on accuracy and things like that. I could do that. And but as far as like, as scraping and stuff like that, we could, I wish I could do more. Maybe again, we could talk to you about making this thing more robust and following through on some of our sort of our crazy ideas to make thing, you know, to make DFS fun.
Yeah, absolutely. Like this started mostly as an analysis tool for me, but again, it ended up being a good way of sweating or watching any of the sports, probably more so than anything at this point. So yeah, I think anything that improves either.
And have you ever considered again, like what I mentioned before, like I know the Will, I mean, reform racer, he told me that he has some tool that does this, and I don't know, like midway through the slate to analyze like who's doing like what lineups look great. You know what I mean? Like based on projections or whatever it is, like how do you stand? Like how would you assess a lineup like midway through an NBA slate? You know, and that has incredible value, like not only just for sweating, but for staking also. You know, if you could assign a value to an entry, you know, midway through the slate, you know, you could try to sell some of that at huge markups to kind of hedge a little bit, or just for fun. It's kind of fun to say, okay, even though I have only X amount of points, I mean, I'm in pretty decent shape because I have the following guys left, you know, and to be able to quantify that, I think would be kind of interesting if there was a way to do that.
Yeah. So there's certainly ways to do that. I mean, like I mentioned, I have stuff like that for the sports I play, because I do my own projections, and that's sort of like the underlying basis of that. And I mean, truthfully, I'm somewhat surprised that a lot of the simulation based DFS companies haven't done that, because they have all the missing piece is the, you have to simulate the slate. So like, but like, you know, companies like SaberSim, Run the Sims, I think most companies, I think at this point, have some sort of like backend simulations. It's really just like applying that to the contest CSV at different points. You know, like, so before the slate starts, everything would be based on simulated results. You know, halfway through, you'd apply the real scores to people who have gone or fought or whatever so far, and then apply the simulation to those who haven't yet. I thought this was coming a while ago. I think there's probably some reasons the sites are hesitant to do this, because what you will see, it can be harmful to the DFS ecosystem potentially if 90% of people, you know, see that their lineups are returning negative 10% upon the slate starting or whatever, like whatever it is. So, I mean, it's like, it also is like, yeah, it would be disheartening, you know, if you're showing your subscribers or whatever are negative EV and people realizing how unprofitable they potentially actually are. So I don't know if those are the concerns. I don't really have intel, but, you know, these sites have, you know, most of the hard part, right? The simulation's the hard part. The applying it to CSV and whatnot's the easy part.
Well, I'm gonna stop recording, but I want you to hang in there. For everybody, you know, you can go to sports. I don't know whether it's a hyphen or dash projections.com and sign up. And hopefully this improves. Well, obviously it's gonna improve, but it's really good already. And you know, I always root for smart guys. so I root for you to continue to excel at this. Let me stop recording.